Okay. So yeah, actually, as you might have noticed, I changed a little bit the title of the talk. Well, I removed the numbers, the digits. Anyway, but we will talk about this later. First of all, how many of you are familiar with ESX generators or Python generators or yield return stuff in C Sharp? Okay, so you might find this stuff familiar. First of all, I will quickly scratch the surface about what are the generators, just to make it familiar. The official explanation of generators is function that can be exited and re-entered later, and actually upon the re-entrance, all the context is saved. So what does this mean is actually you can play and pause the thing, and then you can resume it, and then all the variables, bindings, and values are saved. So this is a very simple example. You define the generator with the generator function with the asterisk in front, and the magic happens, okay, don't mind this console log, whatever. The magic happens when there is a yield keyword, which is actually the placeholder when the your generator execution of your generator function stops. And whatever is after the yield keyword is going to be returned after the execution is paused. When you call the generator function, actually, you create a generator object, which is so-called iterable. Iterable objects in JavaScript are usually arrays and strings, everything you can just iterate through. And you go through the iteration of the generator object with a method called next. When you call method next, actually, it starts executing the generator function. And then it bumps into the first yield. And then it returned everything. It returned the object with two properties. The first one is value, which is whatever there is after yield. And the second one is done, which indicates whether your function has actually reached the end or not. Here you call next for three times. And when you called it for the third time, it returns you the object with value three and done false still, because we don't know whether we reach the end of this the thing. So in order to reach the end, you call next for the fourth time. If you don't want to do this, you can actually replace the last yield with return. So in this case, you call next only for three times. You can also iterate over the generator with a for off loop or with structuring. It will just call the next method of the generator object for you and actually executes the whole generator function. You can actually throw an arrow to the generator object with the generator dot throw, and inside you can try and catch it. Before actually calling the throw, you have to call next to start the execution, but anyway, this is not the point. You can pass the parameters to the generator function the same way you pass to any other. In this case, you pass 5, and then when you execute the next, when you run the next method, it will return you the value of 5. You can call the next with the value, and what will happen actually when you call it with the value, it resumes the execution of your generator function, and it consumes this value, it gets it, and whatever, you can use it later. For instance, here, you have an equation, m equal yield. So what will happen when you run the next for the first time, it will pauses in the right side of the equation, so m is going to be actually undefined. And it will kind of wait for you to get the value for m. So whenever you call the next for the second time with some value, it will assign m this value. It will resume the execution, then it will return in this case. When I said that it's keeping the context, though, what it basically means, if you have this kind of infinite generator function, so you run, in each run, it increments the value of I and it returns this. So each iteration remembers the value of I from the previous one. Okay, so these are the basics. What this is actually all about, why we're talking about the generators. So because we can use them in like different ways, and let's just see quickly what people do with them. So first of all, you can do infinite sequences. Well, you wouldn't do this without, like in the real life probably. Why would you do this? Well, because it's fun. and just, you know, start with something just to scratch the surface of this generator thing. So you can run, you can, this while true generator will never loop unless you, I don't know, call next and loop. So why we need it? Well, let's come back a little bit later. But you can do infinite sequences, or actually you can generate over very long sequences or very long data lists, whatever. And you can pause it and resume whenever you want. What else you can do? You can, well, is it readable? If it's not, don't mind it. I will try to explain. So imagine that you have this kind of stuff. The idea is here is that you can replace some intermediate values, intermediate variables, data that you use for in your methods, and you can replace them, you can get rid of them if you use generators. For instance, imagine here you have a kind of this method, the function, that splits your big array into smaller ones, and you want, for instance, each small array to have the sum of the element not more than 5. Okay, this will not work in all the cases, but just to illustrate your general idea. What this code does, it goes through the long array, and then actually calculates the sum of the elements. Then whenever sum is bigger than 5, it pushes, in each iteration, it pushes the elements into the intermediate array, and then whenever the sum of the elements in the intermediate array is bigger than 5, it pushes the intermediate into the final, and blah blah blah, and continue all over. So what we could do is here, for instance, first of all, we could get rid of the final array. What if we don't push intermediate into the final, but we actually pause the execution at this point and yield this thing? So let's do this a little bit better. So what else we can do? For instance, can we get rid of the intermediate array in this case? For instance, because we don't need to actually remember all this to collect all this element. The only thing we can do is basically remember the start index of the element that we want to and the end index, and then use the slice method of the final array to return only this part. So what I mean, if I make any sense now, instead of collecting the element, we just yield in part of the bigger array. And the way we call this generator again, we can in a for off loop or something like this. What else? We can lazy evaluate things. What does this mean? Lazy evaluate or transform things. Well, if you're familiar with functional programming, it's actually related to the concept of monads. When you transform some kind of data that you, or if you don't want your data to be like null or something, you can actually use the wrapper around your data and whatever, return something if the data are null. And in the case of generators, you can actually lazy evaluate long sequences or of data. For instance, here you have some, you have a so-called filter generator which consumes the items, whatever it is, a sequence of items, and then some evaluate function, and whenever evaluate passes through, it yields this item. So remember when I showed you this random function that generates random numbers, a random generator function. So what we could do with this, we could actually, the idea is that we could get finite amounts of data from the infinite or long sequences by pausing this kind of thing, and then we can resume from the same place and so on and so forth. So in this case, for instance, we have this random thing that generates all the random numbers infinitely. Then we have filter, and then we want to get three first items that satisfy our filter requirement. So we create the third generator function, which consumes the output of the previous one, goes through the sequence of these values of items, and then returns the first three. As soon as it returns three, it stops. And the way you actually execute it is a little bit, it looks a little bit functional. So you can, the result of your function actually is a generator object, you call next, you get three values, three times you call next, and then you can actually resume this thing again. You have to reinstantiate the get three items generator, but basically what you can do is, for instance, with long list of data, you can pull some data, then you, I don't know, you pull first three rows from the database that satisfy your requirement, you pause, you do something else, then you pull again, and whatever, you name it. What else people do? Actually, this is very famous application of the generators. They control async flow, meaning that they allow you to write async code in a sync manner. Because generators can yield promises, async functions, other generators, arrays, objects, and so on and so forth. So for instance, if you have this kind of code where you get some promise, then you wait for the promise to get resolved, then you propagate the result to the callback, or you catch the thing. With the generator, you could do this actually. You could try and catch errors inside your generator, then you can first yield the promise, then you get the value of the promise, then you call the callback, or you call the callback with an error in the catch. All the other stuff that all this, you still have this then and catch and stuff with the promises, but you do that outside of your generator. So when you first create a generator object to do something, it returns you the promise, then the promise actually is the property, is the value of the value property of the object that is returned. Then you call next the same way, you wait till the promise is resolved, and then you resume your generator with the next, or you throw the error with a throw. The good thing, I mean, you don't have to do it manually. There are libraries that do this for you. I mean, just have you read it? I mean, can I switch the slides? So you don't have to do this. There are libraries that do this for you. For instance, Co is one of the most famous. There are plenty of others. I'm not going into this. And what basically you can do with Co is just use it like that without any... It does all this magic for you. And you can yield actually promises. And actually, the thing is that you don't even need to use try catch because Co catches stuff for you. So whenever a generator throws errors and Co and sees that it's unhandled errors and caught, it will actually use the... It will reject the promise that it returns or whatever. You can execute things in parallel by yielding the array of promises. So the call will call promise.all for you. You can also yield some thanks, which are basically functions that require that waits only for a callback as an argument. Okay. I guess I have to slow down a bit. This is a cat picture. There is actually a lot more to say about async, how to control async flow with the generators. I'm not going into that. I put some links in my presentation that there are really plenty of nice talks. So I will just finish with this part. The last thing I wanted to say about the generators, which is how people use them with some heavy, they're called heavy recursions, or actually recursions that can, not infinite, but okay, long enough, and then you want a recursion that you want to play and pause and resume and do all this kind of stuff. So actually how you do the recursion with the generator, you use yield with asterisks. And actually what it does, it actually delegates the execution to the generator, which is after yield asterisk. It can be the same generator or the other one. So what this kind of stuff here, for instance, done, it will, when you create a generator object and iterate through it, so what it will do, it will first yield the value and then call itself with the value multiplied by 2. How people use it, actually? This kind of pattern is used a lot of for some kind of algorithm, like parsing, going through some trees, whatever, binary trees. And people use it for games, like Sudoku game solver. People use it to walk through the folders, for instance, in Node.js. They want to go through the, like, deeply into some folders, and then they want to pause for some reasons, and then resume, and so on and so forth. The first thing, actually, what I was trying to do with it, for instance, you want to, I don't know, load two items, in this case, images at once, like whenever you, like only two images. So what you would do, what I would do, actually, first yield an array of promises with, okay, load image is something that is loaded in the image, consumes the index of the image. So I would yield first the promises, and then I would delegate actually the execution to the, actually I would call itself the generator function itself again with another index. So and in this way, like when you create the generator function, then you use promise all and do all this kind of stuff. So and you can call it again after and later, and you can, I don't know, load two images at once, or load two rows of the data of the table at once, or load something else. The reason why I changed actually the title of the talk, because before I thought that the async generators are going to be part of ES7, they're not, I mean, my bad. So what actually will come, or actually is about to come as the next standard, I guess, is async generator, which are basically the generators that emit promises, and you can use these generators in a for of loop. So here, for instance, you have some get next value thingy that returns the promise. Then you have async source, and you create the async generator function with the async and the wait, all this kind of stuff. So you have async source that actually call this get next value. So it's something that, well, it's sequence that it's kind of generated asynchronously. Let's name it like this. And then you have a run function, the run generator, that consumes this async source and uses for await of to get through it. So why would you do this? Because you can have some fun. For instance, if the WebSocket had this support for the async generators, you could go through the WebSocket messages. You can wait for them, a stream of messages. You can wait for them, and then you can do something else. You can you can send them to another generator. You can transform them. You can, I don't know, you can have some fun. Or for instance, you can do some kind of functional reactive thing when you are go through the streams of user events, and then you do something like that. Whatever you want. Anyway, that's it from my side, and thanks for listening.